Silent Partners by Bob Shaw. Read by Martin Jarvis. At first, he could see nothing about her, except that she was dressed in furs. Then that her hair was blonde, and in spite of the night wind, as smooth as glass. When the woman drew nearer, he made out the glitter of jewellery at her ears and throat, and of gold at her wrists. Then he could see her face, which was beautiful. He didn't know the woman, and yet her face was almost familiar, like that of someone he might have dreamt of a long time ago. Purvey crouched in the utter darkness of the bushes and waited for her to come within reach. From where he'd stationed himself, he could see both lamplit entrances to the tiny park and something of the quiet suburban streets beyond. It was strange, then, that he'd not noticed the woman come through the gates, but perhaps he'd overdone it with the whiskey while he was waiting. It was years now since he'd had to go out and actually rob somebody, and his nerves had needed damping down with alcohol. The outlook in the confidence business was pretty bleak when a practitioner of 20 years' standing had to resort to outright robbery. Taking a deep breath, he slid the pistol from his pocket and quickly stepped out onto the path. "Don't make a sound," he warned the woman. "Just hand over your purse and that stuff you're wearing." He stared into her face, trying to gauge whether she was the type to do as she was told, or the unpredictable, troublesome variety of customer. In the dim light coming from the street, Purvey saw that something had gone terribly wrong with the beautiful face. His hand flew nervously to his mouth, and he took a step backwards, raising the pistol protectively. The woman sagged bonelessly, crumpled, withered away in a second, leaving nothing but a small, dark object writhing on the ground at Purvey's feet. With a moan of sheer despair, he turned to run. He was much too late. Purvey very rarely dreamed, but when he was 12 years old, he'd once had a nightmare in which he'd committed suicide by lying in a coffin with earth and roses in it. The thorns had pierced his flesh and drawn the blood from him, making the roses flourish and bloom, until he'd been sucked dry and was lying dead beneath a beautiful living shroud of blossoms. Then, as one can do in dreams, he'd realized he didn't want to commit suicide, after all. He had that same feeling now. Huge fleshy leaves and dozens of dark green tendrils lay across his chest and face, stirring slightly in the wind and sending exploratory tricklets of cold water into his clothing. Summoning all his strength, he pushed the tangled mass aside, sat up, and realized at once that he was aboard a spaceship. He'd been back and forth to the Lagrangian colonies in moon orbit enough times to enable him to recognize the sensation, even though his surroundings looked less like the interior of a spaceship than almost anything else he'd seen. The low, almost circular room was brilliantly lit from the ceiling in some places and dark in others, giving an impression of shadowy vastness quite out of keeping with its true size. The walls were dark brown and streaming with moisture. Large fans positioned at intervals around the walls were making random-seeming movements on their bearings and creating a cold, irregular wind. The floor was covered with a thin coating of mud, from which jutted a disorderly clutter of instrument pedestals, machine housings, cables, and low partitions. There appeared to be nobody in the room but himself. Purvey scrambled to his feet, almost fell with dizziness, and made his way over to one of the instrument stands, which was emitting a red glow and a peculiar high-pitched whistle which kept changing in tone. On the pedestal was a small screen depicting a few brilliant stars against a background of crimson space. The markings on the dials were little blobs of many different colours. He made a circuit of the room, assuring himself that it was empty. Then he began shouting for someone to come and let him out. Nobody came. Purvey was feeling dizzier by the minute, as though the air contained some insidious intoxicant. He crossed the room, falling once on the slippery mud, and stood staring down at the little view screen, wondering how he got into the nightmarish predicament. All at once, his memory of recent events iced into sharp focus in his mind. The woman in the park. How could he have forgotten that hideously dissolving face, or the way she'd turned into the indescribable thing on the ground? He ran his fingers over the smooth glass of the viewscreen, feeling slightly relieved at the realization that she, it, was not in the immediate vicinity. Something behind him made a wet, slithering sound. Purvey spun round, feeling his mouth drag itself out of shape with fear. The dark green stuff which had been spilling across his face and chest when he awoke had come crawling after him, leaving a broad trail behind it in the mud. In the center of the mass of leaves and tendrils, Purvey glimpsed a complicated knobbly core about half a meter in diameter. Some of the tendrils ended in shiny black beads, which looked as though they might serve the function of eyes. Purvey backed away from the thing and felt in his pocket for the pistol. It wasn't there. When a wall ended his retreat, he stood staring at the moving growth as it labored towards him, propelled by some dimly seen agitation under its core. It stopped advancing when it was about one human pace away from him, and remained motionless for what seemed to Purvey a long, long time. Then he noticed that across one huge leaf on the top of the mass, faint letters bleached out in a lighter green had appeared. The thing was trying to communicate with him. "You shall have gold," the letters spelled out. The black-beaded tendrils waved gently in the air, and the odor of the thing reached up to Purvey, the smell of dusty ivy growing on a decaying wall. Purvey, responding to one of his favorite words, was immediately less apprehensive. "What for?" He sank down onto his heels and tried to peer into the depths of the apparently intelligent vegetation. "Why will I have gold?" Another long pause ensued. Then the green writing faded and was replaced by, "Explosion wrecked part of the ship." Then, "Including repair shop." Then, "Lure has made rough repairs." Then, "You are highly mobile." Then, "You will stand by during trip." Then, "Lure will pay with gold." "I don't know how to repair spaceships," Purvey pointed out, playing for time in which to think. "The work will be simple. You are mobile. I will direct you." The sentences took a long time to come across by means of the thing's, Lure's, controlled etiolation effect. Purvey groped around in his pocket and found a flattened pack of cigarettes and a permatch. When he struck the match, it burned with a large, brilliant flame, and he guessed that the air in the ship was loaded with oxygen. That might explain why he felt so dizzy, almost drunk. He blew out the match with some difficulty, put it away, and drew deeply on the cigarette, relishing it. "Will you take me back to Earth afterwards?" "Yes." Purvey considered asking Lur to promise, but decided against it, as he had no way of knowing how much the vegetable's word was worth. It might be no more trustworthy than some of his friends. "I'd like to know how you got me here," he said. "It seemed a bit, sort of unethical." Not the sort of behavior one would expect from a salad citizen, he thought reprovingly. But there was no reply to his question. He noticed that the black beads had dulled as though Lur had gone to sleep. Purvey snorted disgustedly. He crouched against the wall, coat collar turned up, and finished his cigarette. The only sound in the room was the restless whispering of the fans on the wall above. Sometime later, after a period of uneasy sleep, Purvey woke up with a new problem. The vine-like growths that formed the extensions of Lur's body were draped wetly across him, as they had been on his first awakening. He ended the distasteful intimacy by pushing the dark green mass away, trying to understand why it came near him at all. "Listen," he said suspiciously. "How long will the trip last?" A broad leaf unfurled and the labored writing appeared. 15 of your days. "What about food?" Purvey demanded. "I'll need food." "You shall share the Artor's food." "Artor? What's that?" "Artor is a helper. She brought you here." "I don't want her food," Purvey said, suddenly afraid. "Artor will not mind." Lur stirred slowly and moved away, leaving a trail through which could be seen the whitish metal of the floor beneath. There were small perforations in it, and as Purvey watched, more mud welled up through them until the metal was covered. Purvey followed Lur, wondering if its last remark had been some kind of sarcasm. Reaching a little door low down on a bulkhead, Lur extended a tendril, touched a white circle, and the door opened, revealing a plain cupboard-like interior. At the touch of another circle, a hatch opened in the rear surface, and a block of pink spongy material slid out. Purvey picked it up warily, but he'd been hungry long before his current misfortunes had begun, and he had little trouble bringing himself to taste the strange food. It was slightly warm, chewy, and tasted like lobster paste with a strong dash of red pepper. It was better than he'd expected. When he'd finished eating, Purvey obtained a rather unsatisfactory drink from one of the little rivulets of water which ran down the walls at intervals. Lur had gone to one of his instrument panels and was lying motionless beside it, eye stalks extended and poised over the array of meters. By constant questioning, Purvey learned that the ship he was on was a kind of scout which had been escorting a huge interstellar liner, or battleship. When the accident had occurred, rather than have the mothership stop to give assistance, Lur had radioed that it would be possible for the scout to reach base unaided. If the scout failed to return, however, the mothership would come back and find it. Lur's race only fought wars when attacked by aggressors, but their battleships were very big and powerful. He wandered around the room looking at the alien mechanisms, flapping his arms to keep warm, and trying to decide what was wrong about the place. It was all wrong, of course, being the product of the thinking of an alien life form. But there was another wrongness. Purvey found that he got tired easily. Time dragged by in the monotonous discomfort of the room, and he slept often, crouched in the darkest corner where there was the least mud. This was the place where the explosion had occurred, as was evidenced by the seared metalwork, dented machine housings, and shattered ceiling lights. Purvey liked it best because it was the one place that Lur seemed to avoid. Once, when he was feeling particularly miserable, and Lur was in one of its unresponsive moods, he decided to look for something in which to wrap himself for warmth. His showerproof was heavy with mud, wet and useless as a garment, and he found himself longing for heat in any form. He went to the row of low doors and opened several of them by pressing the white circle, which was a common feature. Inside, he found perfectly normal shelves stacked with unmarked boxes of machine parts, which, although beaded with moisture, showed no signs of corrosion. One shelf was loaded with hundreds of blocks of coloured glass or plastic, another with what looked like purple seaweed. A larger door had a red circle on it. Numb with the cold, Purvey opened the door and saw a little room in the centre of which glowed an old-fashioned pot-bellied stove. He was stooping to cross the threshold when it occurred to him that the stove just could not be there, and he jarred to a halt. Something moved near his feet. Just before he jumped back and slammed the door, he had a blurry vision of a fat, slug-like creature rearing up with grey mouth agape. Lur was suddenly conscious again, holding up his communicative leaf. "I see you recognized the Artor this time." "This time?" Purvey said. "Was that the woman I saw?" Lur seemed quite active and alert as the sentences appeared in answer, noticeably quicker than before. The Artor was a very slow-moving, carnivorous animal indigenous to Lur's home planet. It got close to its victims by telepathically invading their minds and controlling the visual centers to make itself appear attractive to them. Apparently, Lur had muzzled the Artor, fitted it with something he described as a force field grab, and lowered it to Earth to find a human being in a quiet and lonely place. Purvey, who liked quiet and lonely places, had walked into the trap. As a byproduct of their study of the Artor's ability, Lur's people had been able to develop a device which enabled them to detect and comprehend the thoughts of intelligent animals. Purvey eyed his green companion speculatively, rubbing the stubble on his chin and wondering if he'd picked up another note of warning. On the fifth day, reckoned by his wristwatch, Purvey discovered that Lur had been telling him lies. His feeling that there was a subtle wrongness in the setup finally culminated in the realization that there were two entirely separate sets of controls in the room. The set, which was in use and at which Lur spent most of its time, was grouped along one wall. Every part of it, every short pedestal and housing, was constructed with smooth, brilliant metal, and with the high standard of workmanship that Purvey associated with good pinball machines. The joints in the metal were barely discernible, and the little coloured dots that Lur used instead of numbers were perfect circles and squares etched into the metal. The unused set of controls was scattered over the centre of the floor area, and in contrast, reminded Purvey of a radio he'd built during a course of remedial training. There were plates which didn't fit, unfilled holes, bolts which bolted nothing, and the coloured markings were roughly shaped blobs of enamel. Scooping away some handfuls of mud, he found that holes had been burned in the floor to let associated cables and pipes pass through. None of these earmarks of a jerried-up experimental rig agreed with Lur's picture of a standard scout ship serving as an operational vessel. But it was hard to see the alien's point in deceiving him over a thing like that. He carefully refrained from thinking about his discovery in case Lur should be able to read his mind. And acting on principle, he began to take an interest in the operation of the ship. His professional instincts told him he might have stumbled onto something good. Another day went by, speeded now by routine. At intervals, Lur drew some of the pink spongy stuff from the locker and pushed it through a slot in the door to the Artor's room. The dangerous little creature seemed to have about the same status as a pet dog in Lur's life, except that it was never allowed out for its equivalent of a walk. Purvey helped himself to the same food any time he was hungry, and found he was growing to like it. It occurred to him that the leafy alien was quite different to what it had been at the start of the journey. In their occasional conversations, for instance, Lur could print up his little messages faster than Purvey could answer them, and it gave him an uncomfortable suspicion that the mobile vegetable was more intelligent than he. Lur's movements had become increasingly more rapid until he could get around as fast as Purvey, another thing Purvey did not quite like. The only change for the better was that Lur seemed to have got over the strange urge to drape himself over Purvey every time he slept. This made Purvey's rest more comfortable. On the seventh day, it occurred to Purvey that he must be further from Earth than anyone had ever been before. Only two manned ships from Earth had reached Mars so far, although there'd been much talk of sending a third ship to see why the first two had not returned. And here was Don Purvey, halfway to a star. "Just how far have we come now?" he asked. "Pretty far, eh? How many light years?" "I am not used to calculating in your units," Lur replied. "The best approximation I can give you is 6 light hours. "Light hours?" Purvey shouted. "But that means we've just crossed the orbit of Pluto. You told me the trip would take 15 days. Half that time's gone, and yet we're still in the solar system. What's the game?" Lur didn't answer at once. The first hesitancy for days. Finally, "The journey is in 3 stages. Getting clear of your planetary system takes up half the time. Entering my own home system will take up the other half. That is, traveling in normal space with standard drive. The inter-system jump using Lurian drive takes only a few hours." Purvey rubbed his beard and grinned down at Lur. "So that's it," he thought triumphantly. "The new stuff you added to this ship converted it from an ordinary planet hopper to a starship. You invented it, didn't you, Lur? Of course. You just mentioned Lurian drive. You're all alone. There's no big mothership to look for you." The speed of the alien's rush took him by surprise, and Lur had almost reached the Artor's door before Purvey realized what was happening. He ran after it, muttering angrily, but one of Lur's tendrils flicked out and touched the red circle. As the door swung open, Purvey tried to stop, skidded in the mud, and went down heavily on his side. The impact of the fall drove the breath from his lungs. Purvey gasped noisily as he saw the Artor writhe into the room with unexpected speed, pale grey mouth opening and contracting hungrily. Enveloping it were faint changing ghosts of formless objects created as its camouflaging talent reacted on Purvey's whirling brain. He glanced around in panic, saw nothing he could use for a weapon, then scrambled for the row of lockers nearest to him. He opened the door to a compartment and found it was the one full of little glass blocks. The next one contained what appeared to be a complicated valve assembly, and Purvey snatched it from its brackets. The massive piece of metal almost wrenched itself from his grasp as he swung, but he managed to guide it down on the Artor's back. The slug-like body burst open, and the valve sank down into it. A bubbling moan came from the Artor, and the flickering images which had been blurring its outlines abruptly vanished. Leaving his improvised club where it was, Purvey turned in search of Lur. The alien was slithering rapidly towards him with a spiky cactus-like growth extended in front of it. Purvey leapt back, realizing he should have been less squeamish about retrieving his club. He ran across the room, fumbling under his coat until he'd taken off the belt of his trousers. It was of thin, flexible metal. Gripping the buckle tightly, he turned and lashed out with the belt, and luckily connected with several of Lur's upraised eye tendrils. There was a sharp clicking sound as two of the severed eyes hit a partition. Swinging the belt with frightened, loathing haste, Purvey struck again and again until all the eyes were gone. After that, the job was comparatively safe, but it took him half an hour, using the strip of torn metal from the wrecked part of the room, to make sure that Lur was dead. "I'll never eat coleslaw again," he vowed to himself as he gathered up the mass of still-twitching herbage and loaded it into the disposal unit. The operation of the ship was, as Purvey had learned by watching Lur, fully automatic. It was a relatively simple matter for him to cancel the instructions under which the ship's computers were steering it out of the solar system. On a little stylized model of a planetary system, in which a row of buttons was ranged out in a line from a glowing hemisphere, he pressed the third one out to designate Earth. He was betting that the ship would home in on the third planet of any system in this way. The fact that the computer was accustomed to Lur's home system made no difference, because even there, if the ship was deactivated for any length of time, the planetary arrangement would have altered when it was put into use again, making it necessary for the ship to scan the heavens afresh and select its destination. It was a first-class spaceship, Purvey congratulated himself, hundreds of years ahead of anything on Earth. For the gadget that made it invisible to radar alone, he'd be able to get more money than he could ever use, and without having to trust his life to any perambulating plant either. When he'd satisfied himself that he could control the ship, he crouched contentedly in his favorite corner and had his first really peaceful sleep in days. On wakening, he found he had a slight headache, which he wrote off as an aftermath of all he'd been through. But it continued to get worse as the hours went by. After a meal and another sleep, he had to admit, even to himself, that the air in the room had gone stale. Looking around for air conditioning, he found a little grill in the wall below each fan, which meant there was machinery to regenerate the air as it was used up, and that it had stopped working. Sweating a little in spite of the cold, he searched around and discovered a large duct leading into the wall. The duct emerged from a machine housing near the corner where Purvey slept. And going over to it, he discovered a simple, deadly fact. The sides of the housing had been smashed in by the force of the explosion. The air conditioning machine was wrecked. Sobbing with fear, Purvey ran to get tools, then stopped dead. The realization came to him that even if the machinery had been as good as new, he would still be in the same predicament. For when it was working, it had produced carbon dioxide. All at once, he had the whole picture. Lur had been a mobile vegetable existing on photosynthesis, converting carbon dioxide and water into carbohydrates and giving off oxygen in the process. An explosion had wrecked his carbon dioxide production plant during the experimental flip in the starship, so he'd obtained a replacement, Don Purvey. That explained Lur's eagerness to lie close to him at first, and the excess of oxygen in the atmosphere at the start of the flight. It also explained why Lur had speeded up so much when Purvey had been around for a while, breathing out precious carbon dioxide. It had been keeping Lur alive, and the oxygen Lur had given off in return had been keeping Purvey alive. For the operation of a small spaceship, Lur and Purvey had been a perfect team. And he now realized that it had been a mistake to dissolve the partnership. As before, he was much too late.